For years now, you've heard me talk about these white supremacist think tanks. Basically, they try to pretend as if they're just a conglomeration of academics who are giving their pointy-headed opinions on the issues and subjects of the day, along with some helpful recommendations, but that's not the case at all. These think tanks are in fact nothing more than front puppet organizations for rich white supremacists to try to come up with talking points that are meant to appeal to politicians and deceive the public. They use a whole bunch of $5 and $10 words, words as long as your arm, and they always make sure to tell you that the racist rhetoricians spouting what are usually anti-black propagandistic lies, well, this person has a PhD from such and such university. And this person is our senior fellow, or this person holds the H.W. Falk Chair of Who Gives a Damn at our little public policy institute. But these white supremacist groups are in fact the main ones who come up with much, if not all, of the propaganda that you've heard and seen for decades now. And of all of them, there's pretty much no worse offender among these think tanks than the Manhattan Institute. Now, the Manhattan Institute was founded by an English businessman, Sir Anthony Fisher, and an American, William Casey. William Casey was not just an egghead who was giving his pithy little opinions about law, he was also an investor, who would later go on to work for the Nixon administration, but he's mostly known for having worked for Ronald Reagan as his director of the CIA. So right off the bat, we understand that the man who founded the Manhattan Institute was himself helping to promote all sorts of anti-black racism, which tells you everything you need to know about America's intelligence services. The Manhattan Institute is responsible for much, if not most, of the anti-black propaganda and anti-black racial hysteria that we've been subjected to for decades now. Whenever white supremacy is under threat, you can be sure the Manhattan Institute will trot out some of their so-called academics to throw together some absurd word salad that they'll call a book, or a white paper, or an amicus brief, and they'll be claiming all kinds of bald-faced lies. Their goal is to make their anti-black racism seem to be just another arena of intellectual discourse, so their hate tracts can be put on the same shelves as legitimate scholarly research. True scholarship starts off with the facts and goes in whatever direction the facts lead. The Manhattan Institute, on the other hand, starts off with their anti-black racism, and then they carefully cherry-pick select bits and pieces of data, mangle the information beyond all recognition, and then tell people this is what the facts are. And yet, there are publishing houses who are gleefully willing to print the lies that come from the Manhattan Institute. White media cable outlets who are supposed to be left-leaning, they cheerfully have on members from the Manhattan Institute on their broadcast regularly, and they never challenge them, never explain to their viewers who the Manhattan Institute is, what they stand for, and what views they've pushed upon the public. This is a whitewashing of what is a clearly anti-black hate organization. Well, the white media's job is to keep people in the dark, so we couldn't expect any better from them. But fortunately, you have the black media to tell you the truth. Here's a rundown of just a few of the Manhattan Institute's most well-known employees and what they've produced. Charles Murray, a psychopathic white supremacist who himself is a former Manhattan Institute propagandist. He worked for them from 1981 until 1990. And when he first joined up with them, they wasted no time putting their racist writer to work. In 1982, they paid him $30,000 to write a book called Losing Ground. The book's purpose was to stoke hysteria about black people and welfare. Now, Charles Murray is not black. Black people have nothing to do with his existence, have no bearing on his life whatsoever, and yet he has devoted most of his entire life to nothing more than talking about black people in specific, and he has nothing good to say. In 1994, only a few years after he left the Manhattan Institute, Charles Murray published his infamous hate tract, The Bell Curve. Now, for those of you who may be too young to remember, the bell curve caused quite a stir when it was first published, and that's because the book made it a point to say that black people were intellectually and physically inferior to white people. That was the purpose of the entire book, that it was going to be a data-driven demonstration of black people's inherent intellectual inferiority. That he was going to present numbers, charts, graphs, statistics, all to back up the fact that black people are inferior to white people intellectually and by every other measure. That's what the bell curve was all about. The entire purpose of publishing the book was to revive and try to embolden the kind of anti-black rhetoric which up until that point had not been publicly spoken since the 1930s. His book was easily dismissed because it was clearly nothing but a pile of racist pseudoscience rantings and some crackpot racialist theorizing. It was ridiculed 25 years ago, and today it's not even mentioned. It's also no coincidence at all that following the publication of the bell curve, you had all of these white supremacists on the right who started filing one nuisance suit after the other, claiming that my kid, who has all the sense of a marble, they didn't get into this school or this university because some black kid got preferential treatment over them. A pack of lies, of course, but the point is not to be telling the truth. The point is to push whatever they think is going to be harmful to black people and promote white supremacy. Charles Murray helped to lead the charge on that one. Now, if the Manhattan Institute had been helping people like him scribble out their books and find someone to print it for them, then why didn't Murray just publish the bell curve while he was at the Manhattan Institute? This is part of the game the white supremacists play. The white media refers to the Manhattan Institute as a mainstream organization. I'm not making that up. That's how the white media refers to them. Sure, they're right of center, but most of what they say is still within the mainstream. That's how the white media presents them. The Manhattan Institute claims to be just some academics whose politics lean to the right, and the white media pretends that that's all they are. But we know when the white media says mainstream, what that means is they are for what's in white supremacy's interest, without being too vulgar about it. The Manhattan Institute peddles anti-black propaganda morning, noon, and night. But so long as they're not too belligerent about it, the white media will pretend that they're basically some eggheads with some sharp but otherwise reasonable opinions. This is how white supremacy conditions the public to think of blatant anti-black racism as being just another legitimate point of view. But Charles Murray and the bell curve are just the beginning of the Manhattan Institute's efforts to push anti-black racism. When anti-police violence protests were sweeping the country, the Manhattan Institute called on one of their senior fellows, Heather McDonald, to write a book, The War on Cops, where she took cherry-picked statistics and she mangled them beyond all recognition in her insane attempt to manufacture her own custom set of statistics. Statistics that were supposed to say that police aren't racist and they're certainly not discriminating against black people, and if they gun down an unarmed black person, well, that's because black people have killed every cop in America since the beginning of time. In other words, a pathetic attempt to manufacture a narrative where she accuses the victims of police murder of being the perpetrators and tries to claim that the perpetrators of violence are in fact the victims. Now, outside of Fox News and one or two right-wing radio shows, Heather McDonald doesn't get any play. Nobody uses her fraudulent writings to form policy. Neither the Department of Justice nor any other law enforcement governmental body of note cites her work or uses it as the basis for policy. Nobody takes her seriously. Hell, even Republican lawmakers on Capitol Hill know better than to mention McDonald's tripe. Her book is so clearly statisticulation. That word means someone who takes otherwise legitimate statistics and then twists them and breaks them up beyond all recognition so they can manufacture a talking point. You know, there's an old saying among mathematicians, if you torture the numbers long enough, they will confess. That's Heather McDonald's entire MO. If the facts don't say what she wants them to say, then she'll mutilate them until they do. And she didn't give some equivocating apology for all of these police murders of black people. She was saying that it wasn't happening whatsoever, that it's totally untrue. That's the point. Black people have the white supremacists on the ropes. Had the enforcement arm of white supremacy under pressure, twisting the thing till it was ready to break, Heather McDonald couldn't just get out there and say, well, it's not as bad as all that. She had to straight up lie and say, it's not happening at all. So, for those of you who wondered, where did that ridiculous book, The War on Cops, come from? It came from the Manhattan Institute, where Heather McDonald works to this very day. At least Charles Murray had the good sense to leave the Manhattan Institute before he published the bell curve, but at this point, the Manhattan Institute feels emboldened enough now that the white media has given them so much cover and refused to actually tell people who and what they are. They feel as if they've blurred the line between their racist propaganda and legitimate scholarship to the point now where they don't need to have any of their racist propagandists leave and publish their racism outside of Manhattan Institute. Hell, you can go ahead and do it while you work for them now. They feel as if they're that emboldened, as if they've made that much progress at legitimizing anti-black racism. But no discussion about Manhattan Institute racist advocacy would be complete without discussing their current pipe-throwing goofball, Christopher Rufo. Christopher Rufo is the one who the Manhattan Institute tasked with manufacturing their latest white anxiety moral panic, critical race theory. While he wasn't necessarily the first to try to create a moral panic around CRT, Rufo has done more than anyone else to try to make a boogeyman out of this little-known legal theory that's only taught in a handful of law schools. But, as Rufo himself admitted on Twitter, this was always a racial hit job that he was performing. The goal was to take a term that the left used, but it had to be an obscure one, one that people weren't familiar with. That was deliberate. It was so that it would be easier to lie about it. After you find some obscure leftist bit of lingo, you then begin lying about what it is, claim that it's all kinds of things that it isn't, or as Rufo put it, recodify it. That means to redefine it into all these things that it's not. And of course, you would have paid crisis actors who were in the employ of these white supremacist think tanks who would run around pretending as if, oh, our hair is on fire and the world is coming to an end. It's all perverted political theater. But that's not to say that it's all been without an impact. It has helped to galvanize a number of white people, many of whom were already sympathetic and leaning toward that position to begin with. The Manhattan Institute's entire purpose is to galvanize white people now, to get them to take to the parapets to defend white supremacy now. If there was really such a big threat to white people, then they would already be doing so on their own, wouldn't they? And they certainly wouldn't need any rich white supremacist in New York to put out any extremist propaganda just to terrify them into acting. White people still own as much of the nation's wealth as they ever have. They control as many political offices as they ever have, even though their numbers are smaller than they've been in living memory. They're not under any threat from anyone. No one can threaten them financially, no one can threaten them politically, and no one is threatening them physically. White people in America are as safe and secure as they've ever been. So, how do you make the most secure people in human history think that they're under threat? That's where absurd propagandists like Christopher Rufo come in. But it needs to be said that most, if not all, the people you see showing phony outrage over CRT on television, they know full well that what they're saying are more or less lies. Many of the mouth-frothing numbskulls you see screaming their heads off at school board meetings are in fact political operatives in the employment of these very same think tanks, or at the very least, some front company that the think tank uses to do their dirty work. You see them online, and when they're confronted about their lies, they admit that they didn't know what CRT was and that they didn't care. They admit that it's not being taught in their schools, but they also admit that they don't really care because they understand that this can be used to fight the left. In fact, that's one of the most common responses that you get from these anti-CRT protesters. Well, the left does it all the time. These think tanks are political and racial front groups whose job is to hire people who graduated from universities, who weren't smart enough to hack it as professors or senior staff, and have them instead work for a private company where they put together books or white papers or court briefings, and they give these to politicians and the media And they say that based on these academics' writings, the country ought to adopt these policies. You should take this racist tripe seriously because it was written by so-and-so over here who got a BA or a PhD from this or that university. And it's not as if this is some sort of difficult sell to the media. After all, most of the people who are running the white media, they also went to the same universities as the Heather McDonalds and the Charles Murrays and the Christopher Rufos. These are their friends, their university chums. They're part of the same sororities and fraternities as these people. These are their pals. In many cases, some of them actually worked for these white think tanks. So it's not as if they're going into hostile territory whenever they tell MSNBC or CNN or CBS, go ahead and put our guy on and let him say whatever he wants to say. Oh, and don't point out to the people who this guy works for or what the Manhattan Institute actually is. That's the reason why you've never seen anyone do a takedown of the Manhattan Institute on TV. You've never seen anyone expose them. You don't see the white media pointing out, hey, who are these people who we see claiming to be all hot and bothered over CRT? Gee, aren't these the same faces we see over and over again, just a traveling circus? This is supposed to be the so-called liberal media, and yet they make sure to give comfort, aid, support, and cover to these far-right extremists. They work hand in hand. The Manhattan Institute says the things that MSNBC and CNN can't. They never tell you about the methods that these groups use. Last year, I told you about a documentary series by Al Jazeera called The Lobby USA. It was an undercover report about the Israeli government's operations to buy influence in the U.S. and to silence critics of the Israeli government's actions, specifically as it pertains to Palestine. In the fourth episode, they talked about the Israeli government's efforts to try to get black people to support what the Israeli government wants. And they introduced a young black man named Marshall. His actual name is Marshall Kozloff. I'm sure you've probably seen him on YouTube. These days, Marshall works for the right-wing think tank, the Hudson Institute, and he also has a little podcast online. But a couple of years ago, Marshall and his pals were in a fellowship program for the Hoover Institution, another right-wing think tank. Marshall and a handful of other interns were being paid by the Hoover Institute to protest against students who were denouncing Israel's mistreatment of the Palestinians. One of Marshall's friends said that the entire fellowship program was that they had to be foot soldiers for the conservative movement. Even so, this person also admitted they were being forced to do it. Marshall himself joked that his biggest fear was that he would be identified as taking part in what was clearly state-sponsored propaganda and be accused of having sold out for money. He laughed and said, "I'm like, we did. We cost $50,000 plus benefits." This is what these think tanks do. They hire people, literally just hire them, and tell them go to this or that place and pretend to be protesting what we tell you to protest. Now, Al Jazeera reported on this. CNN and MSNBC did not. And neither did your other black bootlicks like Roly Poly Martin or Mark Lamont Schill. Oh yeah, these Negroes, they understand exactly what it is that the white paymasters on pay cable want them to do. They understand exactly how it works. The so-called academics for these think tanks are meant to lend an intellectual air to what are nothing more than the same old garden variety anti-black talking points. They use the same vocabulary that we ordinarily only hear on a university campus, only now they're trying to give some intellectual legitimacy to anti-black racism. They figure if they put some $10 words on top of their tripe and pile on some made-up statistics, see Heather McDonald, and then make asinine claims that every school in the country is teaching kids to hate white people, see Christopher Rufo, then the politicians will think there must be something to it. Phony talking points, made-up stats, and non-existent evidence. Now, obviously, no one can actually be fooled by this, but that's not the point. These think tanks understand exactly what's going on. It's like Lee Atwater said back in the 1970s, whenever you talk anti-black racism, you can go ahead and use coded language, like say it's about downsizing government, which means, of course, getting rid of black employees who work in the government. Or you can say, well, it's about budgetary fiscal responsibility, which means we're going to eliminate any sort of government programs that black people might get any pennies from. and that the white constituency that they're talking to will fully understand without you having to spell it out. You can use those code words and everyone will still understand it. This is what the Manhattan Institute and the Hoover Institution and others, this is the well that they draw from. They don't have to spell it out. Everybody who pretends to be outraged about critical race theory or whatever other anti-black hysteria that these white think tanks promote next week or the week after, they all know exactly what the real job is. It is to keep up a steady drumbeat of black people are a threat. White people are under threat. We're under siege. We gotta fight because we're losing everything. We're losing everything. We're under siege. And it's black people who are doing it to us. We're justified in anything we do against them because we're under threat. Just think for a moment about the titles these think tanks give their employees. Senior fellow, current holder of the so-and-so chair of inter-social studies, etc., etc. These are the same kind of titles. In fact, they actually are verbatim the same types of titles that universities give to their professors. But think tanks aren't universities. Almost none of the crap that comes out of these toilets, like the Manhattan Institute, would be taken seriously at any community college, to say nothing of an Ivy League university, which is the reason why you don't see them trying to peddle their crap there. But the white media doesn't educate their viewers to this, and that's deliberate. They allow these groups to erase the line between legitimate peer-reviewed scholarship and some corporate whore like John McHorter or Heather McDonald or frauds like Christopher Rufo who just make up lies because they work for what are political organizations trying to create a smokescreen they can use to push the same old anti-black racism. Now, Christopher Rufo was employed by the Heritage Foundation before he went to the Manhattan Institute. I told you guys about the Heritage Foundation, founded by the late racist zealot Joseph Coors. I put up a video years ago called Why Roger Ailes Isn't Going Away, and I explained that back in the 1960s, Joseph Coors used to give a lot of money to the anti-black John Birch Society. But after arch-conservative William F. Buckley denounced the John Birch Society, the group was nationally reviled, and even die-hard racists like Joseph Coors were forced to abandon them, though he never abandoned their racist agenda. Joseph Coors decided to use his money to create another anti-black organization with the same purpose as the John Birch Society, the Heritage Foundation. This is who Christopher Rufo cut his teeth working for in his early years of race-baiting propaganda. So if you've ever wondered why Rufo's work is so virulently racist, so psychopathically anti-black, now you know why. And the people who give him a livelihood like the Manhattan Institute, they know it too. That's why they hired him. And now, finally, we come to John McHorter. He's another Manhattan Institute meat puppet. You've had the white cable stations giving him a lot of play for the last couple of weeks, and they're not bringing him on to challenge or impugn his obviously unfounded rantings. Instead, they're gleefully giving him a platform, telling him that they agree with him. They want this racist tripe out there. This is the powers that be telegraphing that they're up to something. And they're using their media to trot out this clown and try to lay the groundwork for it, to prepare the minds of the public for whatever racist ploy is being planned, and of course he'll be the one who gives them permission to do so. Whatever it is you do to black people is not racist. Why? I'm gonna tell you that I'm black and that it's fine by me, and after all, that's all you need. Never mind the tens of millions of black people who say it's not okay. I'm the one black person who'll give you permission to do so. For those fortunate enough to have not heard of McHorter, he's basically Jesse Lee Peterson without the speech impediment. Candace Owens has no academic credentials to speak of, so McHorter is the pretend black intellectual who the white right will occasionally trot out. But for a guy whose specialty is supposed to be linguistics, he ties his forked tongue in knots with all the lies that he tries to tell. He ridiculously denies being a conservative tool. He insists, "I'm not a conservative. I am a cranky liberal, not a leftist, but a liberal." So he's not a conservative, but he doesn't want to be associated with the left either. Did I mention this clown has a PhD in linguistics? He reminds me of another of the right wing's favorite black flunkies, Thomas Sowell. Sowell is supposed to be an economist, but the only thing he talks about is how there's no racism and black people need to pull themselves up by their bootstraps. On a side note, Soul's entire career is basically him going on this or that right-wing sewer TV show or radio program and saying that he's black and he got a degree in economics, so that proves there's no racism. But he doesn't have a career in economics. His career is getting white people to pay him to say that there's no racism. Now, there's no right-wing organization or media outlet who talks to Soul when it actually comes time to discuss economics. When the 2008 economic crash went down, Fox News didn't put Thomas Sowell on. None of the right-wing nuts on AM radio wanted to talk to him either. Same for the right-wing rags like National Review. For these white men, when it comes time to talk about serious economic stuff, when they need information about the economy, they put a white man on, and they'll ask him what's up. None of them talks to Thomas Sowell, because they don't take him seriously. They all know that he's not an economist. He's a black sock puppet who's there to tell them some feel-good anti-black racism so they can say, here's a black guy who agrees with us. And Thomas Sowell knows this too. And the same goes for McHorter. Nobody asks his opinion on linguistics because nobody takes him seriously. Now, before any right-wing nuts try to claim that, well, linguistics is an esoteric field and it's very obscure, so you can't expect McHorter to be very accomplished, I would remind you of another PhD in linguistics who also has made a name for himself for his political commentary, Noam Chomsky. Not only that, but unlike McHorter, Chomsky actually put his degree to use, and he made substantive contributions to the field of linguistics. Chomsky's greatest contribution is his Chomsky linguistic theory, which proposed that all people are born with the innate understanding of the underlying mechanisms of language. Chomsky's linguistic theory mostly has to do with children and how they learn words. Now, that was back in the 1960s when he first proposed his theory. Since then, Chomsky's gone on to make a name for himself almost exclusively for his political lectures. And yet, academics and researchers are still probing Chomsky's ideas on linguistics to this very day. Now, compare that to John McHorter. What has he contributed to his field? Other than hot air and mindlessly repeating white supremacist talking points. He has a degree, but that's about it, and he hasn't done anything with it other than to say that we should listen to his asinine rantings about black people and how there's no systemic racism because he has a degree. But his degree isn't in history, or law, or sociology, or political science, or biology, or economics. If he's going to boast that his PhD gives him some sort of academic authority to deny all the plain-as-day evidence of racism, then is it rude for me to ask how his degree qualifies him to speak? See, the Manhattan Institute plays this game. They credentialize their bootlicks. They play up that so-and-so has a degree from this or that school, and this makes them some sort of authority. How, exactly? Doesn't matter. They have a degree, and that's all that matters. The white media has played the con game of telling the public to listen to the media because the media puts on experts to educate the public. But what goes unsaid is that until the rise of the black media, 99% of the time these experts are hired guns, paid whores who will say whatever the person paying them wants them to say. McHorter himself admitted this. In a piece written for the New York Sun in 2006, he was already trying to explain away his blatantly contradictory advocacy. His employment at the Manhattan Institute was the main charge against him. Now, he couldn't deny that the Manhattan Institute was paying him, so he admitted that they paid him. He also admitted that he's not some sort of freelance contractor who only deals with them part-time. He admitted that they are his employer. He reiterated that the Manhattan Institute is where he goes to work, that it's his job. McHorter was making much hay out of the fact that he had gotten called out for his shameless shilling for Walmart of all people. Sounding just like every other right-wing nut you ever heard, he defended Walmart on the grounds that they provided jobs for lower-income black people. Never mind the fact that if you work for Walmart, that's the reason why you're lower income, because of your employer. He tried to make it sound like he was just making some basic good-hearted defense of Walmart on the grounds of this is who gives jobs to poor people. Now, what McHorter had conveniently left out at the time is that Walmart is also a big financial contributor to Mr. McHorter's employer, the Manhattan Institute. Gee, I guess that's why of all the companies he could have named, he selected Walmart in particular to heap some praise on, but I'm sure that's just a coincidence and it wasn't something his employers told their employee to say. McWhorter weakly tried to deny knowing that Walmart was a financial contributor to his employer, but that says a lot about this clown. He claims to know so much about black people, he's such a great academic, oh, he's such a great man of words and letters, he is so studied and he thinks before he speaks, but apparently he didn't know something that a bunch of high school kids were able to find out and confront him with. About his own employer. That means that either this guy happens to be an imbecile because he's too stupid to even do basic research that you can do in the phone book, or it makes him a liar. In his case, probably both. The Manhattan Institute is a right-wing organization. They're not centrist. They're not nonpartisan. They were founded by William Casey, who used to be Ronald Reagan's CIA director. Now, when the man who was the spy master for racist Ronnie goes on and puts together a so-called public policy institute, what kind of policies do you expect them to be pushing for? Does McHorter actually expect anyone to believe that he goes to work for his employer and yet would be allowed to write anything that they disagreed with? McHorter himself said that he's not a conservative, that he's a liberal, and yet he has nothing critical to say about one of the most virulently conservative propaganda mills on the planet. He ridiculously tries to assert that just because he depends on the Manhattan Institute for his livelihood, that doesn't mean he's not his own man, that he's some sort of shill. Really? So he expects us to believe that he is, as he himself put it, an employee of the Manhattan Institute, a far right-wing organization. They are his employer and provide him with a regular paycheck, and yet he's not their puppet. What employee goes to their employer's place of work and begins advocating against what their employer wants? What employee goes to work for a right-wing policy group and then begins advocating for liberal policies? By the way, did I mention this man has a PhD in linguistics? But of course, McHorter understands exactly what his job is. To lend his melanin to whatever anti-black racism his paymasters are proposing, and then to blame black people for being harmed by these very same policies. He's not an academic. He's a crash dummy. A political prostitute. A sock puppet who racist white moneyed interests can use to spout their lies, and then they can point to their employee and claim that their policies aren't racist because this black guy that they got on the payroll says that they're not. He denies that systemic racism exists. He whines about wokeism and cancel culture, but only as it relates to white men. And of course, he repeats the insane assertion that critical race theory is being taught in every school, home, and hamlet, and that it's the new jihad. He calls it a religious movement in all but name, and he goes into hysterics that it will destroy the entire planet if it's not stopped. For a man who claims to be an academic, he doesn't seem to know that this religion that threatens to swallow the whole world is only taught in a small handful of law schools, and up until last year, practically no one outside of those few obscure law schools had even heard of it. He also seems to be too lazy to do the 60 seconds of Googling that would have shown him that it's not being taught in any primary schools. He's not a researcher, he's a repeater. He doesn't have a single thought in that empty melon of his. His job is to be the black guy who claims not to be a conservative, all the while attacking anything to the left of Nixon. He ignored racist police chiefs and sheriffs, yet denies that there's systemic racism in policing. He all but ignored the Capitol Hill insurrectionists, all the while repeating his Manhattan Institute associate's psychotic rantings about the uprising last summer. Apparently, in McHorter's world, the center of American democracy isn't the U.S. Capitol, it's your local Costco. He was far more outraged about someone running off with a plasma TV without paying for it than he was with violent white supremacists waving the Confederate flag, overrunning the nation's capital, stealing laptops with classified information, and vandalizing the building. In one breath, he whines and decries how black activists constantly point out race, how black people have to stop fixating on skin color and see past it to the fact that we're all human beings. And yet, in practically everything he writes, he makes sure to point out that he's black. He says it every chance he gets. Gee, for a man who thinks that race shouldn't matter very much, he sure seems eager to remind us of his race all the time. His little wannabe academic scribblings, his little opinion pieces, they all read the exact same way. He writes the same thing, he just uses a different headline, that's the only thing that actually changes. He starts off by saying that black people are wrong about racism, and then he mentions that he's black, and then he copies and pastes the same old white supremacist talking points. His credentials are not his ideas, clearly he doesn't have any of those, but rather that he's a black person saying all of this patently laughably anti-black nonsense. That he's basically a freak show of the American political scene, flying in the face of what everyone recognizes to be the truth. Now, let's go ahead and talk about money. Where the Manhattan Institute gets its money from. The Manhattan Institute has a budget that regularly tops $10 million, but where do they get their funding from? Who gives them all the money to operate with? Well, here's a few people who give money to the Manhattan Institute and who sit on its board of trustees. Until very recently, Rebecca Mercer, whose father was Robert Mercer, the billionaire tech investor who bankrolled Steve Bannon when he took over Breitbart and made that into a thing. Robert Mercer also bankrolled Cambridge Analytica, who was responsible, among other things, for pushing Brexit. Well, until recently, his daughter Rebecca was on the Manhattan Institute's board of trustees. And they also have a couple of other folk you might have heard of. Catherine Wilde is a trustee. She's the president of the Partnership for New York City. Now, what they are is an elite chamber of commerce, and their membership is comprised of pretty much all the largest corporations on the planet. Among their roster, she speaks for J.P. Morgan Chase, Microsoft, Citigroup, New York Stock Exchange, MetLife, T-Mobile, the Carlyle Group, Visa, Coca-Cola, Macy's, UBS, Viacom, Revlon, Pepsi, NBC Universal, Vox, Verizon Media, Walt Disney Company, News Corp, and a ton of others. All of them are part of that little chamber of commerce, the Partnership for New York City. And Catherine Wilde, the woman who's the president of that group, she sits on the board of trustees for the Manhattan Institute to this very day. The Manhattan Institute receives money from Bill and Melinda Gates. They also receive money from the Walton family, that is Walmart. And of course, they receive money from the Koch family. This is who bankrolls this anti-black propaganda mill. And all the garbage, all of the trash, all of the sewage that they pump out, the bell curve, the war on cops, the hysteria about critical race theory, this is what the Manhattan Institute does. And they're not alone. I've already mentioned to you the Hoover Institution and the Heritage Foundation. There's also plenty of others. The Claremont Institute, the American Enterprise Institute. There's a whole spectrum of these little think tanks running around, putting out all of these policy papers, trying to use their influence to intellectualize anti-black policies and claim that it's all just a part of legitimate political discourse. The so-called academics who pump out the propaganda for them are a bunch of mental midgets. But what makes these guys dangerous is that there's big money behind these small brains. People like McWhorter, McDonald and Rufo, and Charles Murray and so many others, these people are working as part of an organized effort against you and me. So when we talk about these think tanks, you need to know this is what we're up against. They're not just sitting here putting out racist screeds trying to masquerade themselves as being just regular intellectual position papers. These guys pay for all of these little demonstrations that you see at these school boards and such. They're the ones who come up with these little slogans and put them out there. They put words into the mouths of these politicians. And the white media is not going to be educating you about them because that's how this works. There's a strict hands-off policy where these guys are concerned. That's the reason why you need the black media. Nobody's going to be bringing this information to you because it's not in their interest, but it is in our interest because your interests are our interests. The bad guys have phony baloney astroturf protests. They've got big white supremacist money behind them. But we've got two things that these white supremacist sock puppet organizations will never have. We have the truth, and more importantly than that, we've got you. That's why you see these guys running scared, telling nothing but lies. They're hoping to bury us under a mountain of pale money. I don't call it dark money, I call it pale money. And under a mountain of lies. Whether or not they're successful will depend upon how much we resist them, how strongly we fight against them. And that comes down to you. White supremacy is a team sport, but so is black empowerment. So that means no one can afford to sit on the sidelines. The bad guys make sure to do everything that they can to support anti-black racism. They put their money behind it. They put their muscle behind it. They put their minds, such as they are, behind it. Now, because they're pushing lies, that automatically makes it where they're in a deficient position. But they will still win if the good guys, that's you and me, if we do absolutely nothing at all. So everybody's got to put their shoulder to the wheel. Everyone has to be present and accounted for this. If we do what we're supposed to do, if we are relentless, then what will happen is no matter how many lying anti-black screed books the Manhattan Institute and their fellow travelers put out, in the end, black empowerment is going to write the final chapter on them. And just a reminder that starting tomorrow, I'm going to begin posting my weekday briefs, The Moment of Truth. As with all my other videos, you can stay appraised of when those post by following me on Twitter or keeping tabs on what I post on YouTube.